Let me preface my presentation by reminding you that I do not claim to have the monopoly of wisdom. I remember as a young student of law being introduced to the great Greek philosopher Socrates, and I remember being told then that in those days of yore the oracle of Apollo sent out emissaries into Greece to find out who was the wisest man. And they went yonder into Greece, and they were great thinkers, Aristophanes, Sophocles, and many others. When they went to Socrates, when he was asked, "What do you know?" he said the only thing that he knew was that he knew nothing. And on that account, he was pronounced the wisest man in Greece. I too know nothing. And what I do is to share my experience, not because I have a different understanding of them, but it is my appreciation of those things as I walk across Africa and as I observe the continent of Africa. Yeah. There is a tendency or an inclination to philosophize about the problems of Africa, to intellectualize about the problems of Africa, and sometimes to moralize about them. But the African problems are real. To the Bangala woman in the Democratic Republic of Congo who has no place to rest because of a civil war, the problems are real. To the men and women who cannot go to school or have a morsel of food to eat in Bangui, in the Central African Republic, the problems are real. To those in Mogadishu in Somalia who cannot plan beyond 1 week because of Al-Shabaab, the problems are real. To the women who are escaping from rape to rape in Maiduguri, in northern Nigeria, the problems are real. To the young men and women who risk crossing the Sahara Desert to face the Mediterranean Sea in unseaworthy vessels, saying it is better to die trying than to live in my country, the problems are real. So when we are assembled here this evening, it is not Africa that we are examining. An Africa which, if you permit me to use this medical term, is schizophrenic. It presents a successful Botswana, a successful Namibia, where the GDP is something in the neighborhood of 12,000 United States dollars, never mind the distribution for the moment. But it also presents you with Equatorial Guinea, whose per capita income is 35,000 United States dollars, never mind the distribution. But it also has Central African Republic, which is not at ease. It provides you with South Sudan, the youngest nation in Africa, where the Nuer and the Dinka have risen against each other, and they are slaughtering each other, even in hospitals and in churches and other places of worship. That is the Africa that you have. It is an Africa about which commentators have many things to say. It is an Africa about which they say Africa is rising without ever asking for whom does it rise. It is an Africa about which they say has the fastest growing economies in the world, with Angola at 9% or even more, with Ethiopia at 11% or even more. But tell the people in rural Angola and in rural Ethiopia that the economy is rising, they'll tell you that is voodoo economics. It is only economic romanticists who are writing papers in refereed journals that are talking about this, but on the ground, nothing is happening. They'll tell you about that Africa. And that is why, therefore, my presentation this evening is about Africa unleashing her potential. But one must go back to history in order to understand where we are and where it is that we are going and what it is that we ought to do going forward. We talk about globalization. But throughout history, Africa has always been globalized. The slave masters globalized us. We were commodified. Africa and Africans built Europe and America. Half of the population of Africa was taken away initially by the Arabs on the eastern coast, and ultimately on the western coast, and some from the southern coast, and taken in what was agrarian Europe and agrarian United States of America. And you built Europe and America by the sweat of thy brow. When slavery lost her luster, the colonial project came about. European countries sat, as history will remind you, in Berlin, in a conference that sometimes is called King Leopold's Conference, and parceled out Africa with undue regard to the realities on the ground. Your country was given out to the Germans. And the Germans did not stop there. They went to Tanganyika and took Tanganyika, and they did not stop there. They went to Dahomey and took yet another slider from that western coast. Even Portugal, little Portugal, took big Angola, and they took big Mozambique, and they took Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde, and their neighbors did not rest. They were Johnny come ladies, and they got a sliver of land called the Equatorial Guinea. And the British and the French, of course, took the land share. The Italians tried in Ethiopia without success, but succeeded in Libya. And the Belgians, little Belgium, took the Democratic Republic of Congo. And once again, when colonialism lost its luster and is always instructive, and this is how the world has always been very interesting. And in the morning I was talking about the American Declaration of Independence, which I love. The opening words say that all men are born equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with son and an inalienable right, that among those are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. When they were saying those things, men of color were not contemplated. Even white women were not in the equation. But they did not stop there. In 1945, in San Francisco, in the United States, when the United Nations was being created and it was being said that, well, we are all equal, 3 years later, Henry Fafoot was in South Africa creating a regime as pernicious can be, saying that you Negroids who are present here are nothing but good for drawing water and hewing wood. And this country was to suffer under the weight of that regime. But it must always be remembered that the Africans who are resistant, the Herero resisted here. And almost half the population was decimated. It was not until very recently that the Germans apologized. In Tanganyika, the Maji Maji Rebellion, and in Kenya, my Kenya, the Mau Mau Rebellion. So it was not as if we succumbed. We were forced. And we succumbed by dint of superior weaponry. But in the 1950s, we gained our political independence. And the words of Kwame Nkrumah in Accra, Ghana, ring true. He said that the independence of Ghana means nothing if the rest of Africa is not free. And you will remember that during that period, there were many countries that were gaining their independence. And you, particularly the young ones, will not remember that the African leaders of the day knew who was where. In the West, names such as Modibo Keita of the Sudan, now Mali, made sense. Some of them did not go to school. Ahmed Sekou Touré of Guinea, Nnamdi Azikiwe of Nigeria, and in the same country, Abubakar Satafau Balewa and the Sardana of Sokoto, Sahamadou Bello. They were great Africans. Julius Kambarage Nyerere, Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya, Kamuzu Banda, Kenneth Kaunda, down south here. You still remember, and I'm told he's still alive and well, Sam Nyoma, and the late Andimba Haman. Toivo, ya, toivo. In other words, they were great Africans, and the clarity with which they saw Africa was as astounding as it was titillating. I'm inviting you to take time to read the 32 speeches delivered between the 23rd and 25th days of May 1963 in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. Each one of them, even the one that you did not think much about, had something to say that was sound and good. But of course, the most enlightened speech of the day, man with a sense of urgency and conviction, was that of Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. He exhorted the leaders who are present on that day, let us not leave this hall without one army, without one command force. Let us not leave here without one country with its capital in what was then called Leopoldville, now called Kinshasa. Let us not leave here without one currency. Let us do this because if we delay, we shall get used to our titles and our sovereignty, and the neo-colonialists will influence and divide us. Nkrumah was not a Jewish prophet, nor did he have the gift of prophecy. But he could see as clearly as one ought to have seen at that time that Africa could only realize our potential if Africa united. Oh, he was right. He was right. Because even before he made that speech, the neo-colonialists had started.